blessing of graduates, but also those who receive the sacrament of confirmation, and in general, all of the parishioners here at the Grand Anglican Church. I would think, especially for the adults here, when we look at the world that the children are going to be entering as they reach adulthood, like our graduates, we know that it's not a very good world to live in. Not very safe, not only temporally or physically, but most importantly, spiritually. It's interesting, every day we read on the news about the breakdown of our society, everywhere. And it seems like Satan has used all his cards, so to speak, to try to destroy souls and lead them away from God. He left no stone unturned to attack souls. We see this especially when in big cities there might be a police shooting of some minority, and from everywhere coming out of the woodwork like a bunch of roaches, there's these agitators, rioters, completely destroying civil order. And it's a cause for concern. The very things that we saw in the 1960s, like rioting and looting and demonstrating and things, we see this occurring here and occurring there. People don't get their way, they demonstrate, then the demonstration turns into violence and it gets ugly very quickly. We also see, too, the breakdown of the family. I find it very interesting. I was reading on the news recently about the amount of shootings in Chicago, where I'm from, on Memorial Day weekend. That after only 2 days, Saturday, Sunday, they had already reached, you know, a record number of shootings. And when I looked at a little diagram of the city of Chicago, lo and behold, on the very far south side was Calumet Park. That's the very small town that I was from. And it has all these dots of the shootings. And they said, we haven't even got to Memorial Day, the Monday, and we're already maxed out of the shootings. And there were a record amount of shootings. And for all the quote-unquote education and all the programs that the government tries to throw out to stop these things, and especially gun control, which doesn't work, the root of the matter is broken families. How many of these minorities, these young people, grow up without a father in the home? And it's no wonder they take to the streets, they belong to gangs, it's just a mess. Then we look at the educational system. Our educational system had been hijacked a long time ago by atheists and humanists who try to take God and morality completely out of education. And so you have these young people growing up that don't have a very good foundation spiritually, morally, and not only that, but also emotionally and psychologically. And these young people are very easily swayed by popular opinion and what they call political correctness. I have to laugh, and maybe I'm speaking to the choir, maybe you've heard this before, one of our priests, Father Riesling in Germany, he sent a little documentary about the University of Washington in Seattle. They interviewed these young students, young people, 19, 20, 21, 22 years old, and I'll be discreet about what he was asking questions about, but he said, they said, what do you think of this gender-neutral policy that the government is trying to push upon schools, public schools, that if you do not allow gender people who are not according to their proper gender using the other restroom, what do you think about that? And every one of these young people said, well, that's right. I don't think we should discriminate. If that's the way they feel, I think that we should accommodate them. And the man who was interviewing, he's want to take that stuff further. He said, what if I were to say to you that I think I'm 6'5"? What would you say to that? And they would say, well, you're obviously not 6'5", but you know, if that's the way you feel, you're not hurting anybody. You know, you could say you're 6'5", but he said, would you tell me that I'm wrong? That I'm not 6'5"? Well, I think it's not my place to tell you're wrong. I mean, these young people couldn't even think for themselves. This man is not 6'5". He said, what if I tell you he's 7 years old? Would you believe that I'm 7 years old? Well, if you think you're 7 years old and not from anybody, yes, you can think that. And I wouldn't want to tell you that you're wrong. He said, what if I want to go to the first grade again? I mean, that's obviously mysterious. Should I be allowed to go to first grade because I think I'm 7 years old? Sounds like, I don't know. I think there might be a school that might take you, you know. I mean, it's just ridiculous. The man says, what if I think I'm Chinese? And one of the girls sitting here, obviously, a white man, Chinese. These young people could not even think objectively. They didn't want to think objectively because they were indoctrinated with this political correctness that there's no such thing as absolute truth. That is, the truth is whatever you think it is, whatever anybody individually thinks it is. And if it doesn't hurt anybody, if you think it's okay. So he said, let's put this all together. He said, what if I thought I was a woman? Do you think that I'm a woman? No. He said, let's put this all together. You're telling me that it's okay if I tell you that I'm a 7-year-old, 6'5" Chinese woman. And that's okay. That's ridiculous. That's crazy. And these young students were laughing and whatever. But this is the part of the humanism, the atheism that has been so absorbed into the school systems, dumbing the kids down morally and not only that, but now intellectually. This is very scary stuff. And for our government to say, because they can't, it's not passing the law, we are going to defund these public schools if we don't allow this gender-neutral locker rooms and restrooms. That's so immoral, so corrupt. It's satanic and diabolical. Satanic and diabolical. And how important it's going to be, especially to you parents, to make sure that your children are strong in the faith, that they're strong spiritually, that they are very well prepared for what they're about to encounter. We not only have a very unstable economy in our country, but a very unstable morality in our country, and spiritually, things are very, very, very bad. And Satan's having a heyday with bringing souls away from God. It's not just a matter of education, but I mean, and we're talking about true education, meaning not just the intellectual aspects of this is the way it is, that's the way it is, but it's more importantly spiritual. We need God's grace. We need God's guidance. Because if we don't have God's grace, we're not going to be able to see clearly. And even if we see clearly, if we don't have God's grace, we're not going to be able to do it. We need God's grace to strengthen us and fortify us to stand up for what's right. Even if people make fun of us or ridicule us. And I believe as we continue, our society continues down this path of immorality and on this slippery slope, we are going to be so, going to be looked upon as so out of touch with society that we believe in these absolute values. We believe in God. We believe that we have a purpose in life. There's a heaven. There's a hell. There's commandments. They're not suggestions. They're commandments. And out of that, but as Catholics, we know Christ is founded in one church. There's only one religion revealed by God. That is going to be so, and it is right now, so out of touch that the time may be coming very soon that we will be persecuted and will be challenged legally and otherwise for all these quote-unquote discriminations and all this other stuff. How important it is that we don't minimize the times in which we live, the importance of living a good spiritual life, being close to our Lord and our Blessed Mother, and living our Catholic faith. I'd like to tell you one brief story, and it's an inspiration to me, not because of the physical aspect of it, but rather the spiritual aspect of it. One of our graduates, he graduated 3 or 4 years ago, he went back home, he was a board student, but he went back home to California, started playing baseball for a junior college, he was given a couple of scholarships, and he ended up playing in Omaha for Creighton University. basic thing is this. His brother's in the seminary. His brother's going to be ordained next year to the priesthood. But you know, when they play their games, and this is for college, when the batter gets up to go to bat, each one has a theme song. So there's some guy on the team that his name sounds as Irish. So he has the Irish jig as he goes to bat. You know, this inspires him or whatever. A lot of the baseball players have rock and roll. This young man, he's traditional Catholic. He has the Ave Maria played before he goes to bat. And the funny thing was, the radio station that covers the sports at 6:20 the zone for Omaha, one of the announcers made this crack. He says, "I think this Crawford kid needs to change his music. Needs to change his music." You know, it's rock and roll, and here comes the Ave Maria when he comes to bat. Well, that game, plus another game, threw a big time for him. First time up the bat, a single. Next time, home run. And we're talking about a big field. They played the College World Series. He hit it very well, dominantly out of the field. And as he's running around the bases, his brown scapular sticking out of the back of his shirt. And you can YouTube and see that. It was very, very inspirational. And then he made it, you know, NCAA college team. It's nice. But what's more, to me, inspirational is that he's not afraid to practice his Catholic faith. I mean, he's 22 years old, and a kid has the Ave Maria parade when he goes to bat. You know how cool that is amongst the other players? He doesn't care. But we need examples like that, of people that are going to stand up for their faith. They're not going to be afraid that they're a Catholic. It's what they believe. And by the grace of God, they're going to do their best to be a good example to everybody else. So he's not only a good ball player, but he's also a good example of a good Catholic. And that's the thing that I'd like to share with you. You know, we have a graduation today. We graduate. Those of you who become soldiers of Christ, you get to receive the sacrament of confirmation. How important it is that we don't underestimate how clever the devil is, and how weak we are, and how important is the grace of God. When we think of, in our Lord's time, in Jesus' time, the Son of God, the divine Messiah, walked this earth visibly amongst men, and the very ones who should have recognized him as the Messiah, the ones who had learned it in the law, the Pharisees, the scribes, the high priests, these are the very ones who rejected him and turned against him, and they brought him to Pilate to be crucified because they were blinded by their pride, and by ambition, and their jealousy of our Lord. Here, that moment had come, they waited for 4,000 years. The Messiah is working miracles right in front of them. And he spoke as no one had ever spoken before. He spoke with authority. He spoke with wisdom that no one had ever heard before. His enemies could not even refute what he said. They tried to think of all these ways to trap him. And our Lord, just a few words, just brush them off and humiliate them and refute them. And yet, even then, our Lord was rejected. So in these times, when we think of especially particular situation in our country, and not only our country, but throughout the world, the spiritual blindness that has set in, it should not be a cause for us to doubt. It should not be a cause for us to wonder, is this what we really believe true? Look at everybody else is going this way and doing that. No, absolutely, positively not. Because it's a matter of grace. And if people don't have grace, nothing is going to help and save them. Not help save our country, not help save our society. When you turn your back on God and you go in a different direction, then God's going to let you fall and fall big time. When we think of the abortions committed in our country, when we think of pornography and the immorality and the immodesty and the worldliness and the corruption and how accessible it is with the internet and TV and movies and radio and newspaper, everything is just, the devil is just having a heyday. And this is the world that our young people are going to face. How important it is that we be strong in our faith. We live our faith. The most important thing in life is that we get to heaven. It doesn't matter whether you make money, or you're popular, or you have a lot of fun, and go places and do things, etc. Most importantly, is getting to heaven. That's the bottom line. And that's what we need to do our very best to inculcate The children that we have at this beautiful little school, they're like little gardens. And their tender little plants are growing right now. We have to do our best to save those little plants from getting corrupted and destroyed. And not only that, but also make sure they're watered and nurtured. And that is the reason why I'd like to right now personally thank Father Benedict, Father Anthony, the sisters, our teachers, and all of you lay people who help contribute and support the school. The children in the parish, they are the future. They're the future of the church, the future society. And let us remember that, how important it is that we do our best as adults to protect them, guide them, and most importantly, show them by our example, by our faithful attendance at Mass, and our piety and receiving the sacraments, and our prayer life, and loving one another as Christ has loved us. Let us never forget, too, your patroness, our Blessed Mother, Mary Immaculate Queen. I believe, without any doubt, that the times in which we live are so absolutely satanic, and it is only by the grace of God, through the intercession of Mary, our Blessed Mother will crush Satan's head and destroy his evil influence in our lives and the lives of our families and children. How important it is that we foster a great love and devotion to Mary, wear her crown scapular, pray her rosary, have recourse to Our Lady in all of our spiritual and temporal needs. And let us not underestimate that we are very, very vulnerable. We're very ignorant, we're very weak, and the devil knows our weaknesses and he will try to exploit those things. And it's a wholesome thing to know our weaknesses. It's a wholesome thing to know our faults and failings and our sins, because the devil's going to exploit those weaknesses. And if we're going to persevere in these times, then we need to have recourse to Mary's Immaculate Heart. So for our graduates, congratulations. Those who are going to become soldiers of Christ this morning, become true soldiers. Remember, the soldier, he fights. You're fighting a spiritual battle. And don't underestimate the power and the cleverness of the enemy, Satan and his legions. Let us remember to call upon God the Lord to enlighten us and strengthen us in our spiritual battle, that we might truly be soldiers of Christ and truly be victorious. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.